So I'll start with some discussion on FO model checking, and from that we'll move on to Feigen's theorem and some consequences. So what is the situation here? We are looking at a finite structure, and you are asked whether a formula of a tautologic is true in it, and you have some to the domain A. So the structure, by structure I am always talking about in this case a relational vocabulary. So you have a domain, you have a set, and some n relations given to you of appropriate arity. And so we will be interested in what is the complexity of this, something that probably very easy that everybody knows about. This is just an evaluation problem. You are given the formula and you are given an assignment to the free variables. You just have to find out whether it is true or false, right? So how do you do that? Well, simple way is first push all the negations inside, and then you have an alternating algorithm. The structure is finite, everything is only finite, no? Okay. How does it do? So you look at the structure of the formula. In the atomic case, well, you are already given the structure, so that means you are given the finite structure, interpretation for all the relations, for your atomic formula, just evaluate it, right? You have, it's a positive or a negative atom, evaluate. This is positive or negative atom. And then when it's of the form C1 or C2, choose I belonging to 1 to 2, and then run the model checking algorithm for the same structure where you take the free variables of VI and CI. Sorry. If it's conjunction, universally choose one of the two and do the same as above. For existential quantifier, choose some element of the domain and run the algorithm on, now we have rho with X map to A. And for universal quantifier, universally choose one of these and do the same as above. Now, how much time does a procedure like this take? Well, you have to look at the depth of the syntax tree. So the whatever depth or height of the syntax tree, you have to go down that much time, and then you have to look at the time needed for the variable assignments, right? So the time that we are talking about is length of phi plus, well, on every path what you have to do, you have to look at the quantifier rank many. What's the quantifier rank? You are nesting the quantifiers, the quantifier depth, right? So quantifier rank many assignments, so you'll quantifier rank of phi times. For each of these, you have to look at log A bits. A is the domain here. So you got, so this is this much time, alternating time. What about the space requirement? Well, at any point of time, you have to store the current, you have to store a pointer to the current position in the formula that you are looking at. So that will require log length of phi plus, well, again, variable assignment. You have to store the current assignment, right? For whatever free variable that you are looking at, well, you have to look at the free variables for every subformula because you are going into subformulas. So you look at the width of phi times, again, the, for each of these, this many bits you have to store. So this much space. In case, what is width of phi? The width of a formula is the maximum of how many free variables you've got where that phi prime is a subformula of phi. Closure of phi, we can say, but don't worry. So basically, look at all the subformulas, look at how many free variables are used, and take the maximum, that is the width. So this is this much space. Now, it's a very simple algorithm, and what does this say? That, well, this is alternating linear time, and we know that alternating polynomial time, you can identify with p-space, so this is an algorithm that is in p-space. In fact, it's very easy to, in fact, also show that the problem is p-space complete. How do you do that? Reduction from QBF, the only thing that we know for doing p-space hardness, right? So if you have a QBF sentence, some alpha, right? I want to reduce it to the model checking problem for first order logic, right? That means I have to pick a structure and come up with a first order formula such that the validity of this sentence evaluates to one, if and only if in the associated structure that I have picked, the formula that I have designed is in fact true in that structure. Well, what is the structure that I pick? So structure I pick is very simple. A is 0, 1. I have a unary predicate on it, which is going to evaluate to 1. What's the translation? Not very difficult to guess, right? Because, yes. So wherever you have a atomic proposition P, I map it to, so let's say PI. I'll map it to a unary predicate PIX. And wherever I had something of the form, there exists PI, I'll make it there exists X, XI, sorry. Yeah? And for all PI, I'll translate into for all XI. PXI is what I should do. Right? And that gives you a translation, and it's then on this particular structure where each of these variables can take Boolean values, you want to make sure that the formula that you are constructing, you construct this formula now. So given alpha, you construct this phi alpha, and you can check that the QBF sentence alpha evaluates to 1 if and only if in this structure phi alpha is true. And that tells you that in fact, first order model checking is P space complete. Looking at this, we get further, some more paisa vasool for, after all, defining it that way. What's that? If I fix a formula phi, right, and look at the complexity of model checking of, if I now, I want to look at all structures, A, such that A satisfies phi, right? So the only input I'm going to look at is these structures, and I want to see what is the complexity. Then it's clear that this is something that I can do in alternating logarithmic time, and in fact, I can do it in log space, deterministic log space. So if we fix phi, the model checking that we are looking at is in deterministic log space. Basically, it says that if you've got a first-order definable property, then I can check it algorithmically quite easily, right? if I fix a property and then I'm looking at various structures, graphs having that property, and I want to check, and it says that if it's a first order definable property, then I can check it very easily. That's really what this is about. What about the converse? So what is the statement that I'm saying? If property is first order definable, checking is easy. As a kind of slogan or mantra, I mean, not as a thing. Sorry? No, I want to check. I take these structures as input somehow. We'll see, right? And I want to check whether the input structure satisfies the fixed property, right? Of course, how do you take structures as input? This is the sort of thing that we want to look at. But what about the converse? If I can check a property easily, maybe in log space, can I define it in first order logic? Now, this is not only false, but it's sort of miserably false, right? And this is what Abhishek was spending time explaining to you, that look, there are properties like just that the domain has only even number of elements, right? It's something that you can check very easily, but it's not first order definable, right? And you do an EF game and show that it's not first order definable. Lots and lots of properties that you can check quite easily, but you can't define them in the first order logic over a relational vocabulary that you're talking about. Now, of course, you can say, why fuss about relational vocabulary? Maybe you should look at vocabulary with function symbols, addition, whatever, nice things like that. So I'm not going to take up that. I'm going to just say that we're going to stick to relational vocabulary. There is going to be a lot of stuff on databases and so on, so that should be enough motivation perhaps. But there are other. But question is there some way you can relate logical definability and computational complexity? That's the general question, and that is really what motivates all this stuff. So what we want to do is to relate logical definability. The grand program is that. And computational complexity. For first order logic, we need to do something. Not clear what exactly we should do. But there is this problem already, right? What is, you take a property and you want to take structures as input and check. How are you going to check structures as input? We are used to Turing machines which read words, right? So one good way is to say, I'll have coding. I'll have a code which will take an ordered structure. That means what? Not only do I take these finite structures that I have been talking about, I'll assume that there is some ordering on it. And then gives me an element of sigma star. Well, Turing machines read words, so you have codes. But then logics do not distinguish isomorphic structures. So that means that the coding that we choose should preserve isomorphism or identify isomorphic structures. I'm being loose, but what I want to say is that if you take two structures that are isomorphic, the codes should be the same. And if two structures are non-isomorphic, the code should be different. I'm talking about an if and only if. Now I'm only talking about codes to this thing. You could want. I just want this, right? Yeah. So this is a linear order on a finite set. So got everything that you want, and it should be polynomially bounded. In what? In the size of the domain here, size of the set, right? So if I take a structure and produce a code for it, that code should not be too long, right? It should be poly in the size of the structure. What else will we want? Well, I would want it to be FO definable. By which I mean that I have a first order formula. So something like for every A in sigma, I have a formula for every K. Right? I have a formula of this kind to say that if I take the X barth element in the word that is labeled by A, what do I mean by the X barth element? Right? So what we want to do, so the trick is basically going to be code numbers by tuples. Okay. So you've got this, so you take any relation of arity k, you've got n elements in the domain, you've got at most n to the k tuples that we are going to look at, right? Now, once you have a linear order on the elements of the domain, I can lift it to a lexicographic ordering. Spelling is right, yeah. On a to the k. I take the lexicographic ordering, and again I can define a linear ordering on this, right? So numbers from 0, 1 to n to the k, I can identify with tuples in a to the k, right? So when I talk about the, I can talk about the a bar element, which is actually something here, right? So this is the trick, and this is something that it's easy to do, but unless you work out a couple of codings in exercises in, you know, in the tutorials, this thing is not entirely clear what the problem is, etc. But I would suggest that it's easy to do. You can write a sort of formula for doing that, and this is something we will assume that your coding has. Another thing that we can assume, or rather we will assume, is that the atomic case is efficient to check. So what do I mean by that? I mean, if you've got a structure and I have some R which is in the vocabulary and I want to check that a particular tuple satisfies this. So basically I want to check the atomic case, I should be able to go down, right? Remember, this is presented as a string to me, and the fact that whether this tuple is in this relation or not is going to be somewhere down the string. I should be able to go there and figure out, this is a check that I should be able to do efficiently. Efficiently, linear time, log space, choose your cup of tea, whatever you. So some coding we'll assume. So basically your finite structures, if I want Turing machines to read, they'll be reading not the structure, of course, but codes of structures. So when we talk about a class of structures being in NP or being in P space or whatever, we are talking about the codes of these structures forming, looking at the languages as subsets of sigma star. Yeah? I'm sorry? So I'm saying that, so this is that the X bar element of is labeled A. Yeah, this is what I'm going to, in the structure that I'm evaluating it to. Yeah? Yeah, that property I should be able to. Yeah. So basically, when I go down in the list, I want to find the whatever the jth element by going over to the appropriate tuple, I should be able to check what is the letter of the alphabet that is there. That's a property that I want to define. Because your Turing machine will have to go down in the string, which is coding the structure, and figure out whether a particular letter is A or B or C or whatever. Right? Okay, so if we have these, now we can try to define, given a language L, by which I mean a given a logical language L, a complexity class C and a class of structures, class of finite structures. And from now on, when I say class, I am talking about a class of structures that's closed under isomorphism and over a non-empty vocabulary. So this is something that I'm going to, whenever I say class, I'm not going to write this. Closed under isomorphism. Well, that's important for what you want to do. We say that L captures the complexity class C. If and only if. What is it that we want? Now, you give me any, so one, for any vocabulary tau, right? If I give a sentence, if phi is an L sentence over the vocabulary tau, right? Now I can look at the class of all structures, right? So if I now look at all codes of K, I'm going to assume ordered structures. This is an ordered structure over that particular vocabulary tau, right? Such that satisfy P is in the complexity class C. This is one thing I want, right? So basically, the problem of checking this property over this class of structures is in this complexity class. Can be done in whatever appropriate resources, and the other way. What is the other way? You give me any class. This is over a particular structure. Take any structure in the class. And if I look at A belonging to, take all the structures which take the codes, that is the language, and that language is in the complexity class. Yeah. So now, if I now have for any class of structures, there exists a sentence P such that, again, you have this. The defined K is the class of structures. Okay. One more. For any class K if I take a class that, so here I have to actually write code of K. Right? So if I take a class and take the language that you get by looking at the codes, if it is in the complexity class, then I can define it with a sentence, such that the problem of checking, all, you know, if I take all the structures that satisfy it, is exactly that class. Okay. Now, after all this, can we actually do something with it? And that's really where what we are about. So to think about this, there is one interesting, and it's a famous thing to know, so I might as well mention. So given any first order sentence, I can talk about the set of all numbers such that he has a model of size n. Right? If I take a sentence, now look at all finite structures, finite models of that sentence, it has a model of that size. So this is called a spectrum. This is a subset of natural numbers. And one of the very old questions was, characterize spectra. Another interesting question was, is the complementation of a spectrum a spectrum? Is the complement of a spectrum? A spectrum as well. Interesting questions and important questions. So important that in India there is a, you know, controller and auditor general looking at spectrum problems and, you know, so this is a local joke. Yeah. But in fact, spectra can be thought of in the following way. If you've got a spectrum, there is a first order sentence, right? This first order sentence is over some vocabulary top. Let's say it's over R1 to Rn. I can identify the spectrum of a first order sentence, the spectrum, with models of a second order sentence, which looks like this. Right? Consider a second order sentence where I quantify there exists some R1, there exists some Rn, such that this first order sentence over this vocabulary holds, right? Whatever, if it has a model of some size at all, this fellow is going to have finite models, all finite models of this second order sentence. But this is over the empty vocabulary, over the so in fact, what you can do is, now that you have got this idea that, okay, so why not look at models of existential sentences, second order sentences, which have a string of existential quantifiers of this form, and then a first order sentence over that vocabulary, right? What about finite models of these? Once you have got this, you might as well ask this question over some arbitrary relational vocabulary as well. Phi is over some vocabulary, and then you have quantified away some of them. So those are what are called generalized spectra. So this is something that our UPA ministers would be even more pleased with. Okay. So generalized spectra, now what we are looking at are finite models of sentences of this form. So sentences of this form is what we call existential second order logic, where they're basically, you write these and phi, where this is over a vocabulary which may have these R1 through Rn and some more. And if you like Greek symbols, you call the sigma 1 1. Okay. And Fagin's theorem says that a class is of finite models is a generalized spectrum if and only if it is an NP. It is in this sense that the complexity class NP is identified with class of finite models of existential second order sentences. And so what this talk is really about is a proof of this theorem, and as I said, if we can get some Paisa Vasool out of the proof and see some more. Suppose you are given a sentence in ESO, right? So you are given something of this form. Rm, let's see. Now, I want to show that if I look at the class of all finite structures that satisfy it, right? So take all, now we are, as I said, I'm going to take ordered structures and look at the codes. And what I'm now saying is, the problem is, I have a Turing machine that's supposed to sit and look at some given structure, look at the code of that structure, and see if it satisfies the sentence. And I want to show that that is something that can be done by an NP machine. Right? That's what it means to say that this is an NP. So how is your NP machine going to look at this? So I'm given a finite structure, right? Finite ordered structure, in fact. And now I want to check whether it satisfies this. See. Now, the domain is of some size n, right? Now, take any particular relation here. it's of arity k, then that relation can be represented as a bit string of length. So r arity k, I should say ri ki, can be represented by a bit string of length k to the n to the k. So I can represent it by a bit string of this length. So what does my Turing machine do? It first guesses these end relations. All these bit strings, it just sits and guesses. And then now it checks whether, this is only for our coding. This is a first order. Now, first order model checking, as we observed, is something that can be done in polynomial alternating linear time, is what I said. Well, for this particular, for a fixed formula, it's something that I can do in polynomial time. I have fixed this phi and I'm looking at this input. So here is something that a machine which guesses polynomially many bits and then applies a deterministic polynomial time algorithm. This is what an NP machine finds very joyful to do. So this is something that can be done by an NP machine. So if you give me an existential second order sentence, checking whether a finite structure satisfies that property is something that is an NP. Feigenbaum's theorem says that the converse is also true. What is that? You start with a class of structures that's an NP, I can find an existential second order sentence whose models are exactly those. So how do you do this? This is the coding that we are all used to. So let's assume that we have a Turing machine M. It's operating over codes, so it's operating over the alphabet, the coding alphabet sigma, some delta, Q0, some accepting states, some rejecting states. Is the initial state, and delta is a map from Q cross sigma to -1 for move left, 0 for state, 1 for move right. And what does this machine do? It takes the code of a structure and checks, right? And in time n to the k, where n is the size of the domain, it's going to stop and give an output, accept or reject, right? So it's accepting a class in this way, right? When we say that a class is in NP, what do we mean? There is a Turing machine of this kind which will take a member of that class, a code of a member of that class, and it's a polytime machine. So that means, so if it takes the code of k less than, then where size n in time n to the k, it accepts or rejects. So what is the strategy? The strategy for constructing a sentence? Well, you come up with a bunch of relations, some whole bunch of relations, and a first order formula phi such that the structure satisfies phi if and only if this x bar, these relations, code up the computation table, if you like, of the machine M. This is the idea. You come up with a first order sentence that codes up this n to the k size computation table sitting there. Right? If I can come up with a first order formula of this kind over this vocabulary x bar, then what I can do is the ESO sentence that we are looking for basically is of this kind. So the C that we are looking for will say there exists less than, there exists X bar, less than is a linear order, and this is the sentence that we are looking for. If we do the job of constructing the first order sentence correctly, this stuff can be done, right? So Pratik started with saying how you would write it and so on. in first order batch. And you have a bunch of existential quantifiers sitting in front, second order quantifiers, and this will be an ESO sentence of the appropriate kind. So this is what we need to do. And for doing this, what are the things that we need to do? As I said, we have to code up numbers 1 to k. And this is something, as I said, that we'll code them up by tuples in a to the k. Right? That's the obvious strategy. And sorry, we can define successor. We can define, so given any x bar here, I can define x bar plus 1, x bar minus 1, and for any fixed integer m, I can define x bar plus m. These are all things that I can define in first order logic. That means what I'm saying is that lifting it to the lexicographic ordering is something that I can write in first order logic as well. Okay. So we have formulas for all these things. Now, what is the fee that we are going to look at? This is the usual thing. It's going to have some thing about the starting state and one step or do, let me call it do, and end. Right? How do I write all these things? I have to say that initially the machine is in to the left of the tape, scanning the input code of that structure. And end, I have to say that I'm not in one of the rejecting states, right? And in here, I have to look at a transition. And so for this, I need some predicates and I need some relations. That so for every q, we'll have one xq, which is a unary predicate. This will have the codes of all time t, such that machine is in state q at time t. For every q, for every, actually I don't need the q for this, let me just, for every a belonging to sigma, I'll have ya to be the pairs tr, such that machine in state q reading the rth cell finds symbol A. Right? This is another relation that I'll assume. Ah, yeah. So I started with it. I don't know why I thought. And then something for head. Oh, H I wanted for something else. So, sorry, this is Z. There's our X and Y. To say that at time t, oh, actually I don't need this. Huh? At time t is enough. So that's why I don't have it. Yeah? At time t reading R, that's enough. So at time t, head is at rth symbol. And if I have these, from this it's quite straightforward to write all the, I mean, this end is the simplest thing, right? So let's write that. This says that AND over q belonging to f minus not of xq. It says that I'm not in a final state. I'm not in a rejecting state. Yeah? And of course, we want a code of the last one and so on, so we'll come to that. In fact, you can code 0, you can code the last element, all these things. We'll see. You can do more. But this is for a particular coding for a particular reason. So start, what are the things that we have to say? I have to say that in at time t, I'm in state q0, and I am at time 0, I am at the leftmost position. And here is where I need that coding. I have to say I am reading that input symbol, right? The input. What is the input? The y is going to, what is the y going to say? And over. Now what do I want here? The and over is, we can check whether it's and or we'll see. Alpha A of x bar implies, yeah. It says that if you now look at the code of the input, right? Remember I said my code has the property that I have a first order formula that tells me if I look at the string out there, right, any particular position that I am looking at is reading the letter A. If that is so, my Y predicate should be saying at time 0 that particular symbol is having the value A and sigma. That's the place where you use it. It's the only place where you need it actually. So this is clear. Now I have to say, how do you do the one step? U is going to have two parts. The part that needs no change and the part that says transition. How do you say, when do you say no change? Well, I am reading some symbol A and the head is somewhere else, right? At the next step, I continue to read the same symbol, right? Obviously. Suddenly, some dramatic changes should not happen. So no change says, so if I have got at time t, the exit position is reading A and head is somewhere else, it means and t prime is t plus 1, this is where I do all this, then right, at that position it continues to be A. If the head is somewhere else, right, whatever movement I make, I am not going to change it. It's only where the head is pointing, I will make a change, right. If it is somewhere else, I am not going to do it. That's what it says. What about change? And over q prime a prime m belonging to delta of qa. Let me write. Pre QA implies post. I'm used to writing implies like this. I hope you don't mind. I just got used to it over years. I know that I should write arrow, but okay. So pre QA is going to say. Actually, once we understand the meaning of these things, it's straightforward what it should say, but let's just do this because this is the only one that's going to be of some importance as we go. So if you are in state Q, so you are in state Q at T bar and head is at the R bar cell and YA of T bar R bar, yes, and want. And in the post, okay, so what I want here is maybe I'll call it x and y, sorry. Or I'll do it here. Post is going to have at the next instant I'm in Q prime and Z is going to be Y bar and Y A prime And I have to talk about this move to the left. X and Y are related by this M. Now, there is a little predicate here. Let me, in the interest of time, skip this here. This is just going to say, if M is minus 1, I have got to, Y bar is actually X minus 1, X plus 1. The Z is written correctly. I have to do the coding. I want to skip a bit because time is running out and I want to say a few things. Now, for people who are used to the Cook-Levin coding, is not, this is quite similar, but except that you are using this lexicographic ordering and looking at successor on that. And that's a critical one. That's a non-trivial remark being made. And there is some particular structure here. This is the only thing that we really have to concentrate on. Now, of course, having done this coding, you have to prove, right? This is the sort of thing you always do and say, you know, as an exercise, you sit and show that now I've got a coding for this thing. There are two statements to be proved, if you remember. Right? If I consider a structure, this Turing machine, if it halts correctly, actually that satisfies the sentence. And if I take any structure that satisfies it, my machine will accept it. I'm not going to do this proof. I assure you, you can sit and do it and it goes through nicely. Basically, you have to set up a configuration, the ID of the Turing machine, check that it's coded correctly at each step and go down. There are some subtleties, one thing Kamal pointed out. It's an interesting exercise. But I'm not going to do that. This is only to remark that you, so Fagin's theorem, you can do this coding and convince yourself that existential second order sentences, that is sigma 1-1 sentences, capture NP in a precise way. In fact, you can, I'm just going to mention a couple of things. You can go further and show if we write this as the slogan ESO equals NP. Again, let me write it as a slogan like this, whatever we have talked about. You can do, you can go through the proof, you can think a little more, and in fact, convince yourself that second order logic, if I don't have existential prefixes, if I look at arbitrary second order sentence, that gives you the polynomial time hierarchy. And then we said something about these things are over a non-empty vocabulary, right? What I mentioned spectra. What are spectra? Spectra are finite models of existential second order sentences over the empty vocabulary. That's how we got it, right? Started with first order spectra, and we said I can always put an existential second order, you know, a prefix of that. But there is a bit of a problem over empty vocabulary. In this that I was doing, I said, whenever I write a class of structures, I'm always talking about something that's closed into isomorphism over non-empty vocabulary. Please, when I write kappa, think that. But that's very critical when we are, you know, thinking about this, because over the empty vocabulary, right, how will you represent a string? The coding that we did was polynomial in the size of the structure, right? But if over an empty vocabulary, all you've got is a set, right? Now, if it's a set that, what is the representation of that as a bit string? It will be logarithmic in the size of the structure, right? So the coding that you do will give you something that's exponential, right? This is going to be something that runs in time exponential in the size of the input. If you pursue this logic, in fact, you can show that the spectra correspond to XP time. It's a very interesting line, and therefore you can next P time. It's very critical. Yeah? Next P time. Yeah? And so therefore the complementation problem amounts to saying is next P time equals co next P time. Right? So this is only to say that from just looking at the way you do the coding and thinking about it, you can get some, as I said, some paisa also. Some money for value or whatever. I don't know what's a good English term for it. Anyway, so but actually you can get even more by looking at the coding a little carefully. If you look at the formulas that we have used, right, they all have a particular form, except this fellow here. Actually, I should write it like this, so that you can see the drama. Or over if I did the same thing, but if I had a machine that was not a non-deterministic, an NP machine, but supposing what I was doing was actually a deterministic machine, right? So I start with a Turing machine that's looking at structures, right? And in deterministic polynomial time, comes out and says accept or reject. And I'm trying to code it as a sentence of this kind. What will be the kind of coding that I would be using? Just go down this and see. Now, here something will happen. Here I don't need this disjunction, right? I don't have to go through this for all. Once I have got QA, delta is going to tell me precisely what is the triple that I have got. So I can actually replace this by the following formulas. So I have, I can write this as XQ T bar. I'll have to write one more for. And I'll write x bar plus m implies ya I can split this into three formulas of this kind. Why should I bother? Well, I bother because they have a particular form. These are Horn formulas. Right? These are Horn clauses. I've written it as conjunction with a head sitting here, always with one formula to the right of the conjunction. Well, oh, I forgot. When I was doing the first order model checking, I wanted to look at the Horn case as well, and I forgot, okay. Yeah, so it's because, well, Horn satisfiability is something that we know, something that we can do efficiently. So Horn clauses have a particular status. So there is one suggestion here that maybe if you want to capture not NP, but if you want to look at polynomial time, right, deterministic polynomial time, if you've got a deterministic Turing machine sitting here and you are doing the coding, the logic that you should be looking for is not full existential second order logic, but existential second order Horn of some kind. What is that logic? Right? This gives a suggestion for what kind of a logic that you might be looking for if you are trying to capture P instead of NP. So the logic that we look at is the following. Sigma 1-1 Horn, or think of it as ESO Horn. It's of the form, there exists R1, Rm, and then you have and over I, Ci, where these are, Ci are Horn clauses, which have a particular form. In general, it's just some string of first order quantifiers and Horn clauses using these. Just want to distinguish between variables that occur in the head and variables that occur in the tail. You don't need to do that. Let me just. So the clauses have a particular form. What is the particular form that they would have? They are of the form some head. Okay. form beta 1 and beta L implies some gamma, where each of the beta i's are positive atoms or some FO formula not involving the R1 through Rn. And this is either a positive atom or 0. Okay, for talking about negated one. So this is the Horn clauses. This is a little weird here, so don't worry about it for the moment. I'll come to it a little later. This is, I'm saying, this is simply suggested by what kind of coding you might want and fixing it from the coding that you have in mind. So this is basically the ESO Horn logic. And the claim is that over ordered structures, this logic captures P time. Where do I go? Need some space somewhere for this. May you start using this. Oh. Wow. Sorry, I didn't think of that. It's only red, does it?